He's just an asshole! He's just an asshole! He's just an asshole! And he's gone! What have you fucked?
Audio Theory Radio.
And alright, welcome to another motherfucking thing of Audio Theory Radio.
He sounds so enthused.
Yeah, man, I'm totally enthused.
I'm so happy to be doing this. I'm Droopy Dog. Just kill me now.
Just kill me. But on today's episode, part two of our... Well, not really a part two, but... Part two on Claypool shit, I guess.
Claypool.
But we're doing a...
Claypools.
Les Claypool Retrospective. Yay!
Yay!
What do you think about that, J-Words?
Claypools!
I don't know. Never listened to Claypool.
His name's Claypools.
Claypools.
Yeah, the
him and Jables.
Yeah, Jables. Claypools and Jables. I always thought if I had a kid, I would name him Claypool because that would just sound
Claypool
so cool.
Jones.
Hell yeah, dude. Claypool Jones just sounds like a badass motherfucker.
That'd be badass. So we're going to be talking about basically every Les Claypool album that he's done away from Primus. And there's some that I don't have and several that I do.
He needs to do something with that one guy.
Yeah, man, him and that one guy. What the fuck, Jezebel? Cat. Fucking cat.
Weird looking fucking covers.
Yeah, man. I really like...
I look at this crap, I don't see music, I see artwork.
Yeah, pretty much. Like, there's as much thought in the album covers as there is in the music.
That's what I still think was cool with the new Primus album. Or the Green Naugahyde.
Yeah, it was so weird. You just look at it, you're like, it's like a toy.
It's just a tin cup toy that's riding a little trike or some shit. And a green background, but I can't stop staring at it.
I know. You gotta love that sausage album cover, man.
Yeah, dude. That
boobs.
It's got boobs. And you can join us.
Alright, so...
There's a little vagina there.
The very first album that Claypool has ever done, 1988's Blind Illusion. He was a bassist in this band. I've never heard the album. And...
No, you're not alone there.
Yeah, it's, I don't know, I've tried to buy it on eBay several times, but just never, you know, I'd fucking be like right there at the click buy now and be like, nah, let me see what else I can find. But,
buy something.
Yeah, and I'd wind up buying something else. So after that.
Regardless, you're going to buy something.
So after that, we have Sausage Riddles Are Abound Tonight. Which is basically just an original Primus lineup reunion. Todd Huth, Jay Lane, and Les Claypool. And
I always wondered, is this a dude in a fat suit, or did it
explode
on him?
It's such a weird album cover, man.
What's coming out of the neck? Like, weird.
It's a weird fucking album cover.
I remember staring at this shit for hours back in the
shit.
Day.
Do you remember anything about the Sausage album, Zach?
I remember the first couple of songs.
Because I remember...
Fear. Riddles Are Around. Bounce Night. I don't really remember much because Dad's album skipped.
Yeah, Dad skipped bad.
The hell was that?
He dropped the controller.
This is Riddles Are Around Tonight. Yeah. And,
this is the drummer that was on Green Naugahyde, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
And this one, it doesn't have the... What year is this? 94. So this is after Pork Soda. And what's cool is it doesn't have that weird Pork Soda sound. And it's a little more jammy. And actually, when Dad had this album, I thought it was actually just a Primus album called Sausage.
I did too. I remember that. I thought it was Primus. And he goes, no, it's Sausage. But it's Primus.
And then there's a badass song on here called Shattering Song, where they like fucking jam the fuck out. But like, it has a really cool, you know, jam band sound, like a more straightforward jam band sound than what you normally get with Primus. This part. Shit rocks.
Oh shit, get a poster.
Yeah, like pretty much all Claypool albums now come with posters like that. But yeah, I really like the fucking Sausage album, and I found this one at Goodwill like
Lucky.
4 years ago. Yeah, man. And I was like, wow, man. And if fucking when I put it in, it's been like 98 since I heard any of these songs, and I was like, damn, I remember this. And it like transported me back in time and shit. I was like, that's freaking cool, man. I always like it when that happens. And so after Sausage, we get another Claypool that I haven't heard. It's one that I need to pick up bad because it's technically his first solo album. Les Claypool and the Holy Mackerel, Highball with the Devil. And I've only heard one song on it. And I need to fucking pick it up. It's got a cool ass album cover. You got fucking devil like offering you a glass of drink and shit, and fucking like who's on this one? Like that's a question here. It doesn't even say. Charlie Hunter is on guitar.
I remember this one. I remember when it came out.
Jay Lane's on drums again. And so there ain't really much I can say about this one. I mean, because I don't fucking have it. I don't think none of us have heard it. So skip over that. And we get... Alright.
It's Alive! He actually wrote the lyrics in here. That's the only words. That's awesome. It's Alive.
Now, after those, there are two live albums, Live Frog Set 1 and Live Frog Set 2, from Colonel Les Claypool's Fearless Flying Frog Brigade. And, I haven't heard these except for, I think it's Set 2, which is pretty much Les Claypool covering the entire Pink Floyd Animals CD. And that shit is amazing.
You don't have that?
No, I don't. I had to listen to it on YouTube a couple years ago when I found out about it. Not really, dude, because those are other ones that I've almost bought on eBay before, but bought other shit. But, after that, this might actually be a fairly short podcast. I mean, I don't know. After that, we've got Oysterhead, The Grand Pecking Order. It's the one on your stomach there.
Why was that one on top?
I have no clue. But yeah, I love... This is probably one of my favorite Claypool side bands. Fucking... What do you call it? Oysterhead features Trey Anastasio from Fish and Stuart Copeland of The Police. And to me, it's one of the fucking most ultimate fucking, like, super groups ever.
That is a super group. In some ways, all of these are super groups.
Like, the
or at
song...
at least the Colonel of Bucket, Bernie Brain.
Yeah. This song, the Oz Is Ever Floating, is awesome. And it's so cool because you never hear anyone else singing over Claypool shit. And when Claypool and Trey sing together, it sounds fucking good. But then there's this song, Mr. Oysterhead, which is sort of a cool little funk jam song. You
I don't know why that reminded me of the Who.
Yeah, like, I love that part where it's like, he's an inspiration, he's an inspiration, he's an inspiration to us all. And, fucking, I don't know, man, like, the music is so different on here. Because you get some songs that obviously sound more Claypool, and then you get some songs that obviously sound more fucking Trey Anastasio, like, Take Radon Balloon. Like, this has fish all over it. This is a very fishy song.
It stinks! It stinks!
Like fish! See, this is fish all the way. But it's so chill. It's like one of those light up a joint at your fucking favorite summer festival fucking jams.
It's like, I get the sensation of living in the middle of nowhere. All you see is just fucking trees and grass. And you're in like just a fucking trailer.
Yeah, dude.
You sit out on the front porch. Chill.
Home on the prairie.
Hell yeah.
Look at me galloping on the horses.
See, that's fish. This is my favorite, like, Claypool fucking album by himself, away from Primus. I mean, because fucking, I love Fish, and I love Trey Anastasio, and, like, just that dude together with Claypool, it fucking sounds great. Like, I don't know what it is, dude. I don't fucking know what it is. And then, Owner of the World, last one I'm going to play. Yeah.
I remember this. He played the shit out of this.
Hell yeah. And it's so cool. Like, I don't know, man.
Those vocals complement each other.
Yeah,
well.
It's so weird. It's so freaking weird, dude. Because, like, to me, Trey Anastasio's guitar complements Claypool's bass in a different kind of way other than Larry LaLonde of Primus. But then it even gets better with Anastasio's voice and Claypool's voice together because Claypool has such a distinct Claypool voice. And then Anastasio, his voice is, you know, to me it's average jam band
kind
of voice.
But then again, you've never really heard anyone sing with Claypool.
Exactly, and that's what's so fucking cool about it.
If you can hear someone else sing with Claypool, I wonder what that would be like.
Because, like, I don't think I've ever heard anyone else sing with Claypool other than...
Who would you like to hear sing with Claypool?
King Diamond.
That would be great.
That would be hilarious, dude. It's like two different fucking worlds, man. One fucking sounds like Claypool, and the other one just sounds like Elmo.
What? King Diamond sounds like Elmo,
dude. Yeah, dude. When his voice gets all high, man, like, I'm always picturing Elmo, dude. I'm like, fucking heavy metal Elmo, man.
Just singing Grandma's Home.
Yeah, dude, somebody needs to do that. Somebody needs to take Sesame Street clips of Elmo and put that shit on a King Diamond song.
How do you know there's not already one that exists?
Who knows, man, but it needs to happen if it hasn't.
YouTube that shit.
And so after Oysterhead, I remember when Oysterhead came out, Dad was telling me about it, and he was like, Claypool's got a new band, blah, 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 Oysterhead, and fucking, that's all I remember Dad saying about it. But they need to make a new one, man. Fucking Trey Anastasio and freaking Les Claypool. To me, it doesn't matter if Stuart Copeland's in it or not, It's just, I want to hear another album with fucking Claypool and Anastasio together again. That shit was, is just magnificent. So then after Oysterhead, we get basically an actual studio version of the Les Claypool Frog Brigade with the album Purple Onion. And you know what? I like this album. In fact, I really like the album, but it's an album that I always forget how much I like it until I put it back in. And then here's another poster for you.
Well, I think, I've seen that.
Okay, you already looked at that one.
It's like the only one I saw.
The best song on here is the last track on the album, Cosmic Highway. Now here we have Jay Lane on drums, Mike Dillon on the vibraphone, metal drum, percussion, bunch of fucking different instruments. This album, there's a lot of good songs like David McAllister. There's two of them actually, a part one and a part two. And I like Who Wants to Go to Dee's Diner. That song is fucking cool. But it's like one of, it's another one of the ultimate Claypool jam bands. Like they just fucking jam out on there, and fuck. But then so after that we get Colonel Claypool's Bucket of Bernie Brains. This album is fantastic, man. You have Bernie Worrell, fucking Brain, and Buckethead, and freaking it sounds like a whole nother thing again. Like, fuck, dude. Claypool is just one of those dudes. He's so fucking versatile. And, I don't know, man. Everything just sounds fucking cool. Like, this song, Buckethead.
Awesome. This is broke out the heavy metal all of a sudden. It's fucking superb.
Oh yeah, it's just
the way it's built to go.
Not heavy metal, but some sweet like jam funk. Buckethead. Yeah, that shit is awesome, dude. Like this album kicks ass. Fucking, it just kicks ass.
Yeah.
Then there's a line on the song Thai Noodle where he's like, he'll turn a homophobe gay. Let's see, I'm trying to find some other cool songs to play. Elephant Ghost is an instrumental that's like tight as fuck.
Damn, 4th Street.
But yeah, Bucket of Bernie Brains, dude, you can't go wrong with that album, and I actually wouldn't mind another Bucket of Bernie Brains album. Like, make it happen, Claypool. Fucking make it happen. So what's after that? What is after Bucket of Bernie Brains? Okay, Of Wells of Woe is next, alright. It's the one with the fisherman on the front.
Right there.
Of Wells and Woe, to me, it's the first actual solo Claypool album where it's just his name, and instead of it being like Colonel Claypool or some bullshit like that. And what's cool is his backing band, he calls them the Fancy Band. And I like that.
Was that fancy?
And this one has like a couple funk songs. And then some more Frank Zappa-y kind of
Frank
songs.
Frank Zappa-y.
Yeah, where it's like very, you'll hear like xylophones and shit. Like, here's one of the more funk songs. But it's got xylophones in it, it's fucking cool.
Yeah,
like Vernon the Company Man.
What is the Primus rehearsal EP?
I had that, man. It was a free EP they put out of them jamming in the studio on like four old ass Primus songs, like
What do you mean you had it?
It was a free download. Like the summer before Green Nalgahyde came out.
You didn't put it on a CD?
I did, and I fucking gave you one.
Yeah.
But I don't know what the fuck happened to it. It's on that old, old laptop.
Damn.
Like, this shit just sounds so stony. The sitar, man.
Yeah.
This one's got horns and shit.
It's like a cartoon.
Yeah, dude.
You can almost see it in a Japanese anime. Like, that's when the big ass robot comes and destroys the city.
And then there's Iowan Gal, which is really cool.
Fuck yeah.
Fucking, like, there's nothing, I can really say nothing but good things. And then we have the classic.
Yo,
Robot Chicken song.
Hell yeah, dude. And so after this, is it
a Fungi Info?
Or, yeah. Because then there was all they can't be all zingers.
Yeah, so a Fungi Info is like reworked songs.
Well, he was
songs.
Also on a soundtrack. The Electric Apricot.
Yeah, he did a bunch of songs on the Electric Apricot soundtrack for that movie. And he even played in that movie.
Mm-hmm.
But we were talking during the Rammstein episode of what movie Claypool was in. Primus was in Bill and Ted's Bogus Adventure.
Bogus Journey?
Bogus Journey.
They were.
Yeah, during the Battle of the Bands part.
Really?
Yeah, they finish off Tommy the Cat, he's like, say bye-bye! And then the lady's like, oh, that was Primus. Up next is blah, blah, blah.
You see him for like just a second.
Yeah, man.
They're finishing their set when it pans to him before Bill and Ted go on stage. Well, sort of.
Yeah, Bill and Ted just go on stage and fucking, technically, they shouldn't have won that Battle of the Bands because they didn't play one of their songs. They fucking played a Kiss song. I mean, yeah, it was a huge spectacle with the fucking sci-fi fighting and shit.
They didn't play it. Their future selves played it. So they cheated.
Yeah, they should have been disqualified.
They're like, we forgot to practice. We have to go through time to practice.
This is Little Bill. This is Little Ted. Fucking A, man. Yeah, dude. Their future selves.
How are they not fucking up the timelines by stealing people from other time zones? Putting them out of their element and keeping those girls out.
That, like, was great in the mall scene, though, when but the Beethoven was playing that song. Yeah, that fucking
keyboard, man.
That was awesome.
That's awesome as shit, dude. Fucking awesome as shit. I love those movies, goddammit. I love
Napoleon
those movies.
Playing bowling.
Yeah, dude, man, like, that made no sense to me, but it was funny. And
then he went to the water park.
Yeah, dude, and like Genghis Khan getting the hockey gear and shit, that was funny. But I don't know, I think I like Bogus Journey a little more, man. I don't know why. It's probably just because it was more ridiculous. I mean, fuck, dude.
Yeah.
You got the dumb robot Bill and Ted and shit trying to fuck up their lives.
The Grim Reaper.
That was awesome.
Like, the what?
Evil Bill and Ted.
Yeah,
they were funny.
They were fucking retarded, man. Hilarious. And fucking the Grim Reaper, like
the
Josh
Grim
just
Reaper
said.
Was great.
He fucking,
or when Bill and Ted had to go through hell.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, yeah.
that fucking giant Easter
Best
bunny.
Best 3 out of 5.
That fucking giant Easter bunny freaked me out.
And then they mugged a couple guys in heaven.
Yeah, dude. Yeah. Fucking stole their clothes and shit. And then fucking old dude's gonna be like, what's the meaning of life? And it's like, okay, let's freaking...
Every rose has a thorn.
Fucking recite the lyrics from Every Rose Has a Thorn. Yeah, dude. I fucking love that movie. I don't know. I think I really do like Bogus Journey more than
Excellent Adventure. I do. Excellent it's better Adventure. Than Excellent Adventure.
Because, like, then you got this random scene. They're climbing up through hell, and he's like, dude, if I die, you can have my Megadeth collection. And he's like, well, yes. Dude, we're already dead. And he's like, well, they're yours, man. Yeah, dude.
Oh, they were falling to hell, and he's like, shh, what do we do?
Play 20 questions? Oh, yeah, man. That shit was great, dude. And then the Grim Reaper, man, he started off like, you know, it seemed like he was going to be a bad guy, but then he was just a cool dude hanging out with him and shit. You know, they're running through that fucking department store getting all that shit to make their robot
Stasia.
Buddies.
And yeah, he played the bass at the end.
He played the fucking bass. And, like, it freaking... I love at the end, though, when it's playing the fucking Kiss song. God gave rock and roll to you. And, like, it's showing, like, all these... like newspaper clippings of like how Bill and Ted saved the earth and shit, and then you got that one where it's like the Reaper goes on his own fucking solo rap career or some bullshit.
Oh, did he have a rap in the movie?
Yeah, you might be a king rap. Or a little street sweeper, but sooner or later you're gonna dance with the Reaper.
Yeah, dude.
He was spinning his little cipher around, he threw it and caught the bass.
That shit was awesome, dude. That was awesome. Cause like, all right, take the first one. Cause they both kind of end similar, where like they have this giant spectacle. Like the first one, it was them doing their presentation for school. And
the battle between him and that one guy.
Yeah, the second one.
Wait,
had the...
don't forget, we gotta go back in time and put the key into the cage.
Yeah,
we gotta set a bucket up.
Yeah, it gets so
stupid.
So confusing, man. But then, if you think about it, it makes sense.
So yeah, they had to do it. But at the same time, wouldn't it all already happened?
Yeah, yeah.
The movie should have just been like, it's over.
That shit. That when they got the medieval armor on their
head. Yeah, that's what Zach always said. My favorite part. Heavy metal.
Yeah, man. Hell yeah, dude. Fuck, man. They need to put those movies on Blu-ray, man. Or no, fuck it, put the movies on Netflix and shit.
So then you don't have to get up to put it in.
Yeah, dude, you just click play. And fucking, there you go.
Oh, off topic?
But yeah, man, off topic, but...
That's fun guy info.
Because Claypool led to the...
Yeah, I mean, technically, it's like, another 6 degrees of Claypool.
He farted on stage in the scene, so that counts.
Yeah, and so, a fun guy info, it's like some of the songs were recorded for that mushroom game on the Wii.
Mushroom.
And then.
What mushroom game?
Some mushroom men game or some bullshit.
Oh, Pikmin?
No, no.
I have
Spore.
You said it's fun guy info?
Yeah.
I don't think Spore was the Wii game.
Oh, really?
I think that was a.
It was some mushroom shit. But this album, man, this is the closest you can get to saying this is like a Claypool acoustic album. Because, like, it's so fucking... Like, check out Boomville Stomp.
It's called Mushroom Man, the Spore Wars.
Okay.
Yeah. We still got a Wii in our house.
It's on DS, too.
That sounds like you better get fucked by some buck-toothed hillbillies.
Yeah, dude.
Jesus.
Hold on to a tree.
You're gonna squeal like a pig, boy. Woo-wee!
And then this song, Bite Out of Life, features Eugene Hutz from Go Go Bordello. This is the first time I've ever heard this guy before. And he just... This shit's so gypsy, man.
That sounds like that.
That's awesome.
Yeah, dude.
samples?
Huh?
Who's making that noise?
Yeah, that's Eugene Hutz making the voice. And then, like, I love the song Oh Roscoe because it's a song about a dude who just loves to drink and drive. And it's hilarious.
Sounds like Tom Waits.
Yeah. And so, like, this album, dude, it's just fan-fucking-tastic, man. It's so fucking dark, man. Fucking and shit. So what's after...
His full name is Leslie Edward Claypool.
Ed Claypool.
Leslie
Nielsen.
It's 4 Foot Shaq's last one. When it came out this year.
So really, is that the last Claypool album to talk about?
Except for the new one.
But yeah, the new one. New one hasn't released yet.
So, okay.
Duo de Twang.
Duo de Twang. Is pretty much a cover album. It's really just him and this guitar guy. I forget the guy's name. Yeah, another poster for you. The album's called 4 Foot Shack. And it's basically just... Claypool described it as his fuck-off vacation band. And, yeah, it's just him and that guy.
He got fat.
And, what up?
He kind of looks like Kid Rock in that picture.
Oh, really? But sadly...
He looks like Kid Rock in that picture. It's the hat, it's the glasses.
But this is the only original song on here.
What are the covers?
A lot of them are Primus songs and Les Claypool songs.
They're what?
Most of them are Primus and Claypool songs.
They're his own covers?
Yeah, just countrified.
He covered himself.
Like, here we go. Here's Wynonna's Brown Beaver. Like, this shit's fucking cool, man. Like, this is a fucking swampy stomp album, dude.
That's a swampy beaver.
Yeah, man. Swampy beaver.
It's been fun when we were going out back in the day. We used to go out to Allison's house.
Yeah, dude. Out there at Briar Creek. But then this is basically another Claypool acoustic album.
Staying Alive.
Dude, that's hilarious. But yeah, so this is Wynonna's Brown Beaver. And then there's Amos Moses.
Man in the Box?
Yeah, dude.
Battle of New Orleans?
Battle of New Orleans is great. Then you got Red State Girl from his Fungi and Foe album. And The Bridge Came Tumbling Down is really good.
That was a great bass riff.
Yeah, dude. Like, this shit's like Johnny Cash as fuck.
Boonville Stomp.
Yeah, Boonville Stomp from Fungi and Foe again.
I guess acoustic Claypool was playing without effects pedals.
But then here's Staying Alive.
It's not the other one, but faster.
Yeah.
Stay alive, stay alive. disco about this.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. Just playing that on a banjo?
Here's Man in the Box from Alice in Chains.
Oh my god.
It sounds all Indian and shit.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, wait, I'm Indian.
Yeah, we are.
I'm not sure if we're supposed to be offended. It's got the same bass riff.
Yeah, like a lot of them do, man.
It's all the same bass. He sounds like he's in a box.
And then here's Battle of New Orleans. Like, I really like this one. But yeah, so this was fairly short, so I'm kind of glad we talked about Bill and Ted for a minute.
Bill and Ted.
Now, all right, speaking of Bill and Ted, have y'all seen Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventures?
The cartoon?
Yeah.
I haven't seen it since way back in the day.
They used to have it on Netflix.
Damn.
Dude, it is so dumb, but it's like, it fits. I don't know, man. I watched the first episode. Theme song is dumb as fuck. It's like Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventures. It's so Saturday morning, dude. And but like, it's something about, I remember in the episode, it's like they're jamming in the garage and something about they break this statue or some shit of his mom or his dad's or something, and they go back in time to fucking get another one or some shit. I can't remember.
Why don't they just go back in time and stop themselves from breaking it?
Yeah, seriously, you know, but that makes sense because, you know, Bill and Ted are dumb as fuck.
Yeah, your internet's still fucked up.
They'd be like, you know, I guess this is the best thing we gotta do. But, so what'd y'all think of that Claypool shit? I mean, I know y'all pretty much never heard any of that stuff.
I like that 4 foot chat. That's really cool. I like those covers.
Yeah, that's just pretty fucking funny, dude.
That was cool.
Ham, 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 staying alive, staying alive.
Well, see, I downloaded that when it first came out. I was going to show you about it. I didn't know if you knew about it being
out.
I listened to a few songs. I was like, that's pretty cool. And I just forgot all about it.
And it's like, my favorites, man, are seriously Oysterhead. Like, I don't know what it is. It's just the way Oysterhead sounds with those two fucking guys. But, I mean, shit.
But shit.
Yeah, do we have anything else to really say?
Buy this disc. Buy this disc.
Buy this disc. Buy this disc. But yeah, okay, so I guess I'm gonna tell you guys right now. Basically, this will be the last episode of Audio Theory for about a month. We're gonna put the show on hold because we have a lot of work to do getting ready for October. And basically, we'll have 5 Halloween episodes of Audio Theory ready for October. 3 monster Halloween reviews. Normally we do 2, but basically there will be 2 monster ones and a special one. I don't want to spoil that. And then, since the new Pink Floyd album is coming out, I'm going to do What's on the Shelf episodes for every Pink Floyd album, except fucking Final Cut and Momentary Lapse of Reason, because if you want to know what I think about those albums, go watch the episodes, because I go in full fucking detail, and so
full fucking bitch mode.
Yeah. So if you guys want to follow us on Twitter, check us out.
We have a herpes commercial in one of them.
Yeah, the Zach has herpes on the Momentary Lapse of Reason episode. That's Zach's first episode, in fact. Mm-hmm.
So that's his first case of herpes.
So, If you want to follow us on Twitter, check us out at Monster FT Studio. Listen to our music on ReverbNation/Monster FT Studio. And check out our music on SoundCloud at SoundCloud/Bloody Chuckle Studios. Also, go check us out on Instagram for behind-the-scenes pictures and pretentious pictures of our album covers at Instagram/Bloody Chuckle Studios. And
send us your money.
Yeah, send us your money too. I'll
greatly appreciate
it. I need to make
full frontal nudity, females.
and no, also no check us out on rtgomer.com with us and a lot of people like Miss Nightmare and the fucking other people on there like RT Gomer and fucking Fool's Gold reviews and stuff, and we will hear, or you will hear us, in October.